on today's Prophetic Rewind.
That God's promise is in the womb at this very moment, ready to be born and ready to breathe. That's the difference. And it needs to be fed, needs to be nurtured, it needs to be protected. Just like a child, your destiny doesn't come out fully mature. Lord, we welcome you. We welcome you with open arms and with hearts that are hungry for something pure, unadulterated, is that which is what we are asking for. You are our breath. And today I'm praying that you would breathe upon us, that you would breathe your life into us. But we're not going to ask you to do it alone. We want you to respond to our ministry to you. I bless you. We bless you together as a people, Lord. We honor you together as a people, united in this one thing, the sprinkling of the blood that speaks of better things than that of Abel. Sprinkle the blood upon each life, in each soul. Sprinkle your blood upon each family, each of our families, our children. Let the blood of sprinkling speak of better things. Breathe upon us now. We bless you. We honor you in total surrender. You are so lovely and magnificent, Lord. We have no complaints whatsoever. And everything challenging in our mind, you are able to answer. We lift our hearts and our souls because we want to be restored. Lord, would you be blessed by us? What can we do for you? What can we do to bless you, Lord? What can we do to honor you? We thank you. Now, Lord, I pray that you would take us to a higher place, that when we worship you, we may do it with an understanding and a perception of the kingdom. Yours is the kingdom. Kingdom come. Yours is the power and yours is the glory forever and ever and ever. Our Father who is in heaven, we bless your name, the sacredness of your name, the antiquity of your name. Lord God, Yahweh Jireh, Yahweh Shalom, Yahweh Rapha, Yahweh Nissi, Yahweh, the Lord, your name is to be glorified, and we thank you for it. We bless you, Lord, that as your name is glorified, every other spirit has to bow its knee. Let heaven be a witness today that we as a people stand on this earth limited by space and limited by time, and yet we still lift our hearts before him. Angels have no restrictions of time. They have no restrictions whatsoever, and yet we stand in this limited body, Lord, and bless you, bless you, bless you. Oh, you are welcome in our midst today. You are welcome in our nation, Lord. We bow to the Yeshua, the Lord God, who reigns, who lives now. As we worship you and surrender to you, we pray that you would honor us and the faith that we have towards you. He that comes to him must believe that he is, and he is the rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Now, Lord, speak today and bind every force of darkness that is trying to steal our praise, steal our prayers, steal our breath, steal our joy, steal our peace. You are powerless to steal, because the God who is our life is rising up today. Let God arise and his enemies be scattered. Let God arise and his presence destroy our enemies. Let them melt before his presence like wax before the fire. I pray for that. I call for America. I call for the nations of the earth, and you, United Nations, who would stand against Israel and even try to draw America into your plot to cripple this nation. We pray for the peace and the prosperity of Israel, of Jerusalem today, Lord God, and we pray that you would come into this country and that you would speak to the leadership and remove the corruption and the lie to not to bless Israel. We bless Israel today, and we bless Ecclesia, the church who he's raising up today, the church of the Almighty God, who can and will praise him for who he is. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you, thank you. Now we surrender to you. We surrender to you. We are going to speak about prophetic timing and movement. Movement is important because if you think about the children of Israel were not supposed to move until the cloud moved or the pillar of fire moved. This is important for you to understand because nothing could take place unless God moved first. Motion is very important. And so you've got to know, and that's what I prayed this morning when I prayed over all of us. I prayed that we, as the children of Israel, would know when the pillar of cloud is moving, or the fire is moving, or the cloud is moving. In other words, we want the same perception. Give us clarity to know, okay, he's moving. Because remember something, they waited. The word is tarried. They waited, and then when the cloud began to move, they moved. When the pillar of fire moved, they moved. And then if they did move ahead of it, then they were stupid because they were without God's providence. That's very important because motion is to be detected. So we need a motion detector inside of you so you can know he's moving. I need to move as well. He is standing still. God does stand still at times, as we know. And the children of Israel received manna from heaven and so on. This is very important for you to understand because people are saying, I don't really know if I am at the right place at the right time. I'm not sure if I'm out of God's timing. Is God able to redeem my time? If I've lost out on time, if I've missed it, if I've run ahead, am I able to get back? Absolutely. He's a God of redemption, which means to rescue. He's a God of restoration. Now, David also needed a sign of motion before he could go and advance against his enemies. Sometimes it's not necessary to actually advance. Sometimes it's not necessary to go into spiritual warfare simply because it's not necessary. Sometimes God can take care of it like he did with Jehoshaphat. Okay, so what I'm really saying is we want God to lead us to the right place. Now, if you think about your destiny, you think about the promise that you have inside of you. Every person has a dream. Every person has a destiny. Every person has maybe a promise that they've received from God or they have it in their heart to do something. And you know, if you think about a mother, and I thought about this, preparing for the birth of your baby, are you preparing for the birth of your promise? Are you preparing for the birth of your destiny? Are you preparing for the birth of your favor, your breakthrough, your big moment in time? Or is it going to spring on you by surprise and then you're in trouble because I wasn't prepared for this? And I thought about Amanda and I thought about mothers in general. Mothers love their children before they're even born. They prepare for the birth of their child. They have the names picked out. The rooms are painted appropriately. Clothes are neatly folded and books picked out to read. A mother really ever needs to be told to love her newborn infant. She's prepared for it. When the infant comes, everything is ready. We don't do that with our destiny. We wait for it to arrive and we say, well, we don't have room for it. We haven't prepared clothing for it. We don't even have a name for it. But the mother knows the child is coming because the mother feels movement. That's the difference. And the way she has to convince her husband is to say, put your hands here so you can feel it yourself. That's the difference. And that's important for you to understand because that's called quickening. And when there's a movement, you know, and of course, and when there's growth, you know, it's getting closer and we can go through the whole deal, but it's all about movement. So when the child is born, even during the terrible twos or the tumultuous teens, they love their children. We love our children. So why do we treat God's promise any differently? God's promise is in the womb at this very moment, ready to be born and ready to breathe. That's the difference. And it needs to be fed, needs to be nurtured, it needs to be protected. Just like a child, your destiny doesn't come out fully mature. Your destiny does not come out at 21 years of age. It's impossible for that to happen. It comes out like a child. I know this may seem simple to you. I know this may seem a little odd for me to say this. But most people that receive a promise prepare little for it. They're not ready for it. When God spoke to Elisha, the prophet, when the kings came to him, the king of Israel and the king of Judah came to the prophet and said, we have a problem. We are stuck. We don't have water and we are on our way to go to a war. And therefore our livestock are dying. The soldiers are dying. We don't have any water. And this is what Elisha said. And I find it amazing because it's also preparing them for something big. Are you preparing yourself for something big? Are you preparing yourself for something huge? If you're not, when it does come, it's going to spill over and you're going to lose it. How is your preparation at this very moment for what's about to happen? Because you see, if you're not prepared for it, you're going to lose it. Now, a lot of people don't believe that, but it's true. And so he told the kings, he said, go back into the valley and dig huge holes in the ground. They're called ditches. Dig these ditches, every one of you, your family members, dig a ditch because water's going to come. And the bigger the ditch that you dig, the more water you're going to contain. The other thing that Elisha said was, and don't look to the wind, don't look to the clouds, don't look to the rain, because that which you are acquainted with is not going to give you your provision. He said it's going to come from another place altogether. I want to say this to you. Stop looking to your natural resources. Stop looking to your job. There is another source that is coming away, but if you're not prepared, you're not going to have it. Now, that's what he told them to do. He said, dig the ditches. Once they dug the ditch, some of them said, let's just dig a massive one so we can have more water. Some people say, why does so-and-so have more than I have? Maybe they dug a bigger ditch than you did. Maybe their preparation was filled with faith. I want you to fill yourself with faith today and say to yourself, am I truly prepared for the millions and the billions that are going to come into the kingdom in terms of finance? Am I ready for children to come? Am I going to prepare myself for this? And listen to me, you can do it because that is what prophetic prayer is all about. Thank you. Now, so the preparation is important. Once you've dug your ditch, the hole, when the water comes, and it didn't come from the rain, it came from Edom, from a place they least expected. When the water came, God used it in a fashion to destroy the enemies without them having to do a single thing. We're not teaching on that today, but I'm going to move into prophetic prayer for the next thing, because some of you are saying, what is prophetic prayer? Prophetic prayer is like breathing. Prophetic prayer is perception-led prayer. Write it down. Perception-led prayer. Prayer that is led not by your need, but prayer that is led by your perception. Most people come before God with their need. Their needs lead their prayer. Your need leads your prayer. And that's a problem. Not altogether, you can have that as well. But what happens is you have need-based prayer. Need-based praise. And so everything is, I need, I want you to do this. Lord, will you help me with my problem? It's fine to do that. But prophetic prayer says, what are you showing me to pray about? And that's why he said in the scriptures, Paul said, that the Holy Spirit knows what you ought to pray. And therefore will lead you and pray through you with utterances that cannot be uttered, groanings that cannot be uttered. In other words, you don't even have to put it in English. It's there. It's inside of you. So prophetic prayer is perception-led prayer, praying what you perceive, praying what you receive. Let me go move a little further. What is prophetic prayer? It's revelation-led prayer. In other words, God reveals something to you, and as a result of Him revealing it to you, you have faith, and that faith causes you to pray, and it causes you to pray with a greater revelation. In other words, you already know the outcome before you begin to pray. So what you do is you move from prayer to praise, and you begin to praise Him for the answer before He's even answered the prayer. So revelation-led prayer is you pray what is revealed to you. And the problem with us is we've always got these needs in front of us. Our sin is always before us, so we bring our sin before Him. But what does God reveal to you beyond your sin? What does God reveal to you beyond your need? Today I was praying for my need, and then the Spirit said to me, now, would you like to know what I'd like you to pray for? Kim, right now the USA is being tempted to turn against Israel. My prophet, I need you to pray. And forget about your needs and whatever your wants are, and I want you to pray what I reveal to you. Well, God, show me what you're going to do. He said, I'm going to turn them upside down. I'm going to cause a humiliation to come into the White House. I'm going to cause a humble spirit to come upon this president. Because if they're going to go the way of turning against Israel, then there's going to be trouble. But God said, pray for the prosperity of Israel. Now, some people get tired of that and they say, well, Kim, come on. We cannot always pray. Listen, it's up and down all the time. The enemy is tempting this nation. So in other words, I was praying what was revealed to me. Now, let me teach you a little lesson in breathing. For those that know how to breathe, it sounds a little stupid for me to teach you how to breathe. But I'm not going to teach you how to breathe because you know how to breathe. The problem is you don't know how to breathe spiritually. Your soul also breathes. As I've taught you in the soul teaching, your soul has eyes. Jesus says, if your eye offend you, cast it out. He wasn't talking about this eye because he said eye and not eyes. And so if our eye offended me, we had to have everybody on the earth walking around without one eye. He was talking about the eye of the soul. Your soul has eyes. Your soul has ears. Your soul breathes. Your soul can be suffocated. You don't have to think to breathe. Does anybody here think, oh, I better take a breath? You can even sleep and breathe. You find that funny, Danny? Why do you breathe? Because, listen, you're going to like this. Because the atmosphere exerts pressure on your lungs. Come on. And forces you to breathe. Come on now. Pressure makes you breathe. Wow. I knew I wouldn't get an amen on that, but you know what? We're talking about the spirit. When there's pressure on our soul and there's pressure in our lives, we go and we rebuke Satan. We rebuke him. We call it demonic. Instead of realizing that we are holding our breath and God is exerting pressure so that you can breathe. Why must I breathe? So I can live. Why must you live? So you can express God's power, express your thoughts, praise, do whatever you want to. That's why it's more difficult to hold your breath than it is to breathe. In the same way, and I'm bringing this to a prophetic conclusion, prophetically you enter into a spiritual environment. Prophetic prayer leads you to a prophetic environment, a spiritual environment, wherein God's presence and grace exert pressure. Hold on, Kim. Are you telling me that God's presence and grace exerts pressure? Absolutely. Yes, it does. Why? Because he wants you to breathe. I'm trying to find a better word for it because people are saying, well, what do you mean by breathing? Well, let everything that has breath, let everything that has breath, listen to the millions of people saying it. All over the world, say it again. Let everything that has breath, come on, let's do something here. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. If you don't have spiritual breath, you have no divine expression. And let me tell you something. This earth is void of a divine expression. This earth is void of a prophetic expression. Most people are just taking advantage of the people of God by telling them it's the end time. You've got to sow your money into us. We're putting fear out there. I say it's time to end this fear nonsense. It's time for us to realize that there is a globe that is waiting for the manifestation of young people that can tell that there is a God on the earth, but yet still be so powerful and so excellent. We need some people that are excellent in their work. We need some excessive power to come out of these young people all over the world. You're going to realize that even though it seems bleak, the pressure is causing you to breathe. Remember that. Let everything that has breath, praise the Lord. Now, you say, well, the breath is your own breath. No, it's a spiritual breath. In the same way, we enter into a spiritual environment. God's presence, God's grace, they exert pressure. An influence in your life. Okay. So a lot of churches you can go to, they don't have breath. They're a bunch of starchy people holding their breath. I'm serious. It's just there's no, you know, I was speaking to Ricky Miner, who is part of Jay Leno's team, the music man, and they are putting together a studio where they have analog and digital. So they are combined together so that at least there's some breath. Because digital takes the breath away. The oxygen, the breathing. Perfect, perfect, perfect timing. Not one little mistake. There's nothing better than a mistake. Frank Sinatra said the same thing. Frank Sinatra said, they said, do you ever get nervous? He says, absolutely. And the people love it. Because they feel untouchable. So they feel that they can relate to me. Digital is so absolutely perfect that it takes away our breath. And this has entered into the church world as well, into the church service as well, where everything is ordered so perfect. We don't want to make a mistake. But yet, when there is breath, there's fun, there's joy. Prayer is the normal response to that pressure. What does giving birth require? And you can relate to this, Amanda. Giving birth requires breathing. Why do you think they go to these classes to breathe? What in the world is that all about? Come on, think about it. I'm going to classes to learn how to breathe. Why? Because it is essential in giving birth. Am I right? Giving birth requires breathing, especially when the pressure is at its maximum. And then the labor pains. We men do not understand, so I move on. But let's speak about reason versus revelation. Kim, where are you going with this? Listen to me, please. What is your pressure doing to you? Your pressure, you think about an athlete. As he more pressure comes, he breathes. When I went to the military, they said, stop breathing so fast when you're running. He said, take your stride in your breathing. I was learning how to breathe. That's right. Yeah, that's good. I thought, how stupid is this? They are now teaching me how to breathe when I'm under tremendous pressure physically. Kim, you're going to get a stitch. You're going to get tired because you're running. Do this. You see what I'm saying? So you're breathing. They taught me how to breathe under pressure. What's that going to do with us? It's all about the prophetic. What is your pressure doing to you today? It's giving you more life and moving you to a higher place. Okay, so we've dealt with that. You can breathe by way of revelation. God reveals himself to you, reveals knowledge to you. Or you can suffocate by way of reason. I'm going to say that again. Now we're talking about spiritual stuff here. You can breathe by way of revelation knowledge, or you can suffocate by way of reason. Now, reason is necessary, but all revelation is also necessary. And the problem is, we move into reason when there's a lack of revelation. If God's not showing himself, if there's no revelation knowledge, if he's not speaking to his church through his prophets and through his spirit, what happens is we turn to reason. It's important that you hear me out today. I don't believe that reason and revelation contradict each other. Both are fountains of knowledge, if you wish. Both come from God. But reason is based on sensory data. This is important to realize. What we can see, what we can feel, what we can hear, what we can smell, what we can touch. That's what reason is based on. Revelation is based on a whole lot more. While reason can lead us to believe in God, only revelation can lead us to actual God. Let me say that again. Reason can lead us to believe in God, but revelation knowledge leads us to him. Not just believing in him, but actually encountering him, experiencing God. How many of you are experiencing God every day of your life? Do you sit at your desk? Or do you sit at your computer and just stop for a minute and say, I want to feel him here. He's here. Very few people do that because he's invisible. We don't see him. We cannot feel him. But you can actually. Because it leads into your sensory. Ultimately. Moses was led to God. Wise men were led to the baby Jesus. You have to be led by the Spirit. Now, let's move to the next level, which is revelation and signs. We need signs. A lot of people say, well, I don't need a sign. Jesus said, a wicked generation seeks for signs. They were seeking for a sign that he was actually the Son of God. We're not seeking for that sign. But we need signs that come with a revelation. David receives a revelation from God regarding his victory over the Philistines, and God gives him a sign, and the sign tells him that it's time to advance. The time to advance against your enemy is right. Now, when he said all of that stuff, today I want you to move out of reason. Stop trying to work it out. Stop saying how and get the how out of you. Let us for 1 minute conclude that he just loves us. He has no problem with me whatsoever. Can you believe that? Everybody watching me say these words. God has no problem with me whatsoever. Because of his son. Now, if you have that attitude, but Kim, you don't know my sin. Stop it. Forget your sin. Forget your failure. Forget your weakness. God has no problem with you, and he's asking you to believe what he said. God is not a man that he should lie, or the son of man that should change his mind. Has he not said it, and will he not do it? Has he not promised? Will it not come to pass? Now we're going to move over to where God spoke to David and said to him, when you hear the sound in the tops of the mulberry trees, then you shall advance quickly. Now, why do I tell that story? Because there's a time for everything. There's a time to advance and a time to stand still. So David did what the Lord commanded, and he drove back the Philistines altogether. So now what I'm going to move you to today is a very interesting teaching. And it is about the prophet Samuel and Saul, who is chosen to be the king. And I'm going to show you how Saul missed it to such a degree that he lost the kingdom of God. Now, I'm going to read you, first of all, at the inauguration between the prophet Samuel and Saul, who was out on a need, a journey of need. This is what happened. For those that know it, bear with me, please. Saul, in the Old Testament, has basically gone on a journey to find his father's donkeys who were lost. It's a big deal to him. Now, many of you may have heard my teaching on this, and many of you may not have. So I want you to stay with me as I teach this to you. Samuel takes a flask of oil and anoints and kisses Saul and says, "The Lord has anointed you commander over his inheritance." And he tells him this fascinating story. When you go today from here, remember something, Saul came to him because he needed to find out where his father's donkeys. He didn't care about anything else. When he got there, he had an offering which he gave to Saul. And that offering that he gave to Saul, to Samuel, excuse me, was so that he could tell him how to meet his need. How can I find my father's donkeys? That's all I'm worried about. Most people in their journey of life are simply wanting to have their needs met. That's all they want. They don't care about anything else. The prophetic takes you out of that need-based prayer life journey to a kingdom perspective. Now, Saul is standing in front of Samuel, and Samuel says, "Oh, you are the king of Israel." And Saul does the looking around. "You're talking about me?" He says to me, "I'll tell you what I want you to do. I'm going to anoint you and tell you what your destiny is." Because that's what the prophetic does. Now it's going to be uncomfortable. But you're going to begin to breathe. Because you're only thinking about your need, and I'm moving you to destiny. So Samuel anoints Saul and says to him, "You're the commander of Israel, but you're going to go on a journey." And I'm going to read it to you. It's in 1 Samuel chapter 10, I believe, and it's verse 2. That's right, 1 Samuel chapter 10, verse 2. He says to him, "When you have departed from me today, you will find two men by Rachel's tomb, and they will say to you, 'The donkeys which you went to look for have been found.'" In other words, you stumbled into destiny. You stumbled into the prophetic. You gave an offering into the prophetic. Now I'm sending you on a journey, and as you leave from this place, you are going to meet men, and they're going to bring the good news to you that your father's donkeys have been found. Why were they found? Why was the need met? The need was met because he entered into destiny. He entered into the prophetic. The minute you enter into the cloud of the prophetic, the environment of the prophetic, your needs are immediately met. Now, he says, from there you're going to go to a tree by Tabor, which is Mount Tabor. And the word Tabor doesn't have a specific meaning, but it could mean to purify and declare. And when you get there to the tree of Tabor, three men will be going up to God at Bethel, house of God. They will meet you. One will be carrying three young goats, another three loaves of bread, and another carrying a skin of wine. Good for you, God. Make the guy happy on the way there. Now, Saul doesn't know what's going on, just like you and I. God, this huge word comes out. You're the king of Israel. Kim, you're a great prophet, stand before kings. I don't know anything about it. So you go on a journey. And on that journey, first of all, your greatest need is met because you're on the prophetic journey of destiny. And secondly, you have provision. They will greet you and give you two loaves of bread, which you shall receive from their hands. I'm going somewhere. If you're reading with me, verse 5. After that, you shall come to the hill of God, where the Philistine garrison is. Problem. Wait a bit, God. I didn't think there'd be Philistines, because that's the enemy, on the hill of God. He doesn't tell Saul, you're to fight them, you'll overcome them. He says, you're going to find the Philistines are there. So what? Because something's going to happen. Everybody watching me all over the world, say this with me. There is another man inside of me. Don't say, the lady say, another person. There's another woman. That's it. Another man. Now, for those that are saying, you're getting a little weird here, schizophrenic, hold on. There's a man of destiny inside of you. There is a person inside of you that is victorious, powerful, influential, that has what it takes. And the prophetic has to release that being that is inside of you, and that's you. See, we live with our failures and we think that's it. But there's another side of you. I said there's another side of you. And he's just found out he's not just someone that lost his father's donkeys, but he is a king. So he says, you'll come to the hill, the Philistine garrison. And he says, this is what you need, Saul. And I want everybody to listen to me. What you need is what's about to happen. He said, forget the Philistine garrison, because most people will be concentrating on the enemy. What are they doing here? Are we supposed to overcome them? He says, ignore them. You see, we think because there's evil and wickedness around us that we've got to take care of each one on the hill of God. The Philistine garrison are there. And he says, just move on, because when you come to the city, you're going to meet a group of prophets coming down from the high place. You're going to meet a bunch of prophets coming down from the high place with stringed instruments, tambourines, a flute, and a harp, and they will be prophesying. Now, here's the problem. Saul has never prophesied before. And this is what you need. You need a group of prophetic people around you so that it can enhance the gift and bring you to a higher place and draw out the other man. Okay? Then verse 6 says this. Then the Spirit of the Lord will come upon you, and you will prophesy with them and be turned into another man. Or, as the scripture says, the other man, the king. In other words, the prophetic presence, that's why you come, that's why you hear, that's why you join me each Saturday and Wednesday, because it has a prophetic presence. We have been to the high place. We have been prophesying. By the time we get on a Saturday at 12 o'clock, we have been singing and praising and prophesying. All you have to do is join us from the high places. And I guarantee you, once you begin to sing with us and prophesy with us and agree with us, you will be turned into the other man, the man of destiny, the man of hope, the man of life. You are immediately changed and you are turned into it. Now, this is beautiful, because he says, and let it be when these signs come to you, that you do as the occasion demands. In other words, for God is with you. In other words, because you have now entered into this journey, whatever he said before you, take your hand, put it upon it, because it's going to be good for you. Whatever opportunity comes your way, just do it. Then you'll go down before me to Gilgal, and I will come down to you. Now, here's the issue. And this is where we come to the timing aspect of your journey. Because most people miss it with timing. Saul, Samuel says to Saul, now, all of this is going to happen. And by the way, all of it actually happened. He says, but when you get to the city, you go down to Gilgal, and I will come down to you, Saul, king, to offer burnt offerings and make sacrifices of peace offerings. Now, hear me out. In other words, what we're going to do to solidify this calling of yours, we are going to offer offerings. But there's a time for it. That's why I have my teaching on the time. And he says, 7 days you will wait till I come to you. In other words, this is going to be a prophetic offering. It's going to be led by the Spirit. Wait for the 7 days. Wait till I arrive, says the prophet, which speaks of the Holy Spirit. And then I will show you what you should do. Now you must remember, Saul has been changed into the other man. Now the test comes. Wait for 7 days till I come to you and show you what you should do. You know, our problem, our biggest problem is we miss the timing of God because we're in such a hurry. If you think about an Ishmael, how was Ishmael born? Because of the sensory issues, because of reason. Abraham said, you know what, there's no child, I've got so old. And Sarah actually suggested it. And Hagar the servant was the one that had his child. But that wasn't the one that was supposed to come from his body through Sarah. And when God says, it's you, he means it's you. He said, Sarah will bring forth this child, not Hagar. Isaac must come through your wife. And that's how it's going to happen. Now we know the story. Ishmael is born out of fear, out of doubt, unbelief. The Ammonites, the Moabites are born out of Lot's daughters impregnating their father out of fear and unbelief. Human action is frequently the hasty result of passion or fear. And usually it's followed by regret and alteration. I've got to adjust to this. I've got to adjust to this problem I had. I've got to make an alteration here. And so we've got to realize that when God calls you to do something, there's a timing for it. Kim, how can I miss the voice of God? How do I know if it is the voice of God? If it's fear, don't move. If you are afraid or you are fearful, don't do a thing. Don't move. Never move out of fear. Be led and directed by that which you sense in the environment, in the spiritual environment, and in your soul. Samuel says to him, you have 7 days, and then I will come and offer the offering with you. Now here's what happened, and you must hear me. Saul waited for 7 days, and Samuel never turned up. The people were afraid because the Philistines were mustering to get ready to attack them. Now, the Philistines are about to attack and they are waiting for the prophet to come to offer an offering so that they can win the victory. And King Saul is getting really mad. So the people who are following Saul trembling, what's going to happen? What are you waiting for? The enemy is getting closer and closer. What must we do? Now listen to this. So he waited the 7 days and Samuel didn't come. Samuel was a little bit late. You know what? Sometimes we think the Spirit of God is late, but he's not. He was testing him to see if he was prepared to wait before he offered his offering. And Saul said, bring a burnt offering and peace offering here to me. And he offered the burnt offering. before Samuel arrived. It happened as soon as he'd finished presenting the burnt offering that Samuel came. Saul went out to meet him, and he greeted him. And Samuel said, "What have you done? Why did you offer this outside of my timing?" And he blames Saul, and he says to him, "When I saw the people were afraid and scattering, the enemy was coming closer, and you did not come in the days that you appointed. Listen to this. I said to myself, the Philistines are going to come down on us at Gilgal, and I've not made my offering to the Lord." Most people don't even get this. You have an enemy arising against you, and we don't understand how powerful it is to offer our offering to God. "Therefore, I felt compelled, and I forced myself and offered my offering. It was driven by fear, competition, religion, and pressure. Today, I want you to do me a favor." This is very, very important that you understand it. He gave his offering out of fear, out of religious intimidation and pressure. How many of you out there have had this happen to you through various ministers or ministries throughout the earth, that you have given, forced yourself because you were driven by fear, by competition, by religion, or by pressure? That's what Saul did, and that's where the majority of people in the kingdom of God, that's what they do. Kim, what's this got to do with timing? Because there's a perfect moment, perfect alignment, and the way that we practice it is when God says it's time, we actually come to the altar and give.
Thank you so much for joining me again on this wonderful Monday, or whenever you're watching, for Prophetic Rewind. This is a very, very special thing to me. This project, Prophetic Rewind, going back and finding those incredible moments with my dad and sharing them with you, because they're timeless and they're incredible and they will continue to feed you. And even if you've heard it before, you hear it again, and it'll be all new to you again, just like it has been for me. And many of you have never heard it before. And so you have an opportunity here to be blessed by that. And I have a lot of things that God has put on my heart to do with the legacy of my father. I have an album that I'm working on, digitizing his products, books, the re-releasing of School of the Prophets. There's so much more, so many things that I want to share with you. And so when you give to Prophetic Rewind, you're helping me to do that. And so I want to thank you to everybody who has given to Prophetic Rewind. And if you feel like God is telling you right now to give toward the legacy of my father and to these projects that you will eventually be able to partake of and have, I encourage you to click that red link right now. But I don't want to waste any more time. Let's go back and keep watching.
Never feel forced into a performance situation. Never feel that you have to ever give under pressure. And so the rest is history. What happened to Saul was, because that happened, he said, "You've lost what I had to do." And that won't happen to you, but it's about a timing issue. I want every person to watch me now. Today, I'm going to pray that God redeems your time. The time that you've lost, the time that you've lost, the mistakes you've made, remember something, he can redeem your time and hasten it and give it back to you. Many of you feel you've lost out, you've sinned against the Holy Spirit. It's a lie. You wouldn't be watching now if you've actually sinned against the Holy Spirit. I want you to pray with me, and I'm going to ask you to do this tonight. Every person watching, say, "Kim, I want to stand with you, and at this very moment, I know I have a promise. I know that you've given me a special word about my family, about my future, about my business, my industry, whatever, your ministry, and yet you feel that you've lost, you've got nothing. I want us together today to bring our offering before God and say to him, 'Lord, I want you to take my offering and do what you did with Samuel and with Saul. I want you to take my offering like Saul gave his offering to Samuel, and I want you to speak destiny over me. And then I want you to adjust and align me so that I'm at the perfect place.' Do it today." Let's pray together. Father of light, you have made all things possible in your time. Everything beautiful in your time. I pray today for every person watching that they, as they gather around this altar, they would move reason out the way. They would dig the biggest ditch that they can. They would prepare their hearts. And Lord, as they stand with me in this moment of prophetic unction, I pray that you'd speak to everyone and show them how they should give today at this altar. And along with the prophetic anointing in me, I pray that as they give, as Samuel said, the Lord will show you what to do. That's the key right there. Now pray and say, show me now what you want me to give. And as I give to you, show me what I must do. Redeem my time, and I will not come before you empty-handed. Amen. Now all it is this has become a prophetic offering. What does that mean, Kim? It means exactly what I taught you. You're aligning yourself with the perfect time of God, and he will now show you what to do. That's what they said to Samuel. Let's pray. Release it in their hearts. Release every word that you've spoken and bring them back to the perfect place and show them what to do. There it is. You know what I love about the prophetic is you get so close to the heart of God. You hear his mind, his thoughts, what he plans to do. You know, you need this on a regular basis. And there are millions of viewers all over the world that experience this twice a week, sometimes even more, at my den. And you can experience it as well. I would love to have you there. All you got to do is go to kim.tv. We have so much. We have worship. We have songs that come from the heart of God, prophetic words about things that have not happened yet. That's what we say to the people, welcome to the future. And I want you to experience that.